an invitation to worship this morning. We are God's church.
We come together to worship.
He has given us his word.
We come together to learn from him.
He has filled us with his power.
We go out to bring others to him.
He called us into his family.
We come together to share our lives.
He has put his words on our lips.
We go out to tell the world about him.
He has given us his spirit.
We come together to celebrate.
He has showered us with riches.
We go out to share his goodness with others.
He has freed us from our past.
We come together to move forward.
He has planned for us a glorious future.
We go out to live our lives to please him.
We are God's church.
And we come together to worship.
Amen.
Amen.
Welcome to worship.
Welcome to worship, yes.
It's lovely to read those words and to feel a sense of being a part of something bigger than we are, perhaps in our own rooms, just wherever we are right now.
So it's good to welcome you to the Salvation Army here on Crosby Street. We're here, you're there. We're still scattered and we're still waiting, aren't we, as the days and weeks unfold to find out what the way ahead is. But this morning we're looking at Acts chapter 2.
Acts 2, yes, and these challenging words that have been encouragement for churches throughout the centuries. Mm. But as we step into these words this morning, we're still remembering that Jesus is our way. He's our destination, but he's also our pathway as well.
So we're going to sing together a lovely song reminding us of God's faithfulness to us throughout all the seasons. Let's sing together, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
as we come to pray just now, we're going to look into five different areas of who we are individually and as a church as well. Five areas we give thanks for and ask God to bless and to use. So we're going to be thinking about how we can learn together, how we can build relationships, how we can pray together and meet needs and also add to our numbers. So let's just pray in these moments. Heavenly Father, we think about how we learn together. We thank you that you've given us your scriptures, your word that feeds our very soul. But help us to learn, not just to know, but to learn and understand, to be wise. We pray that the church, our church, would be devoted to learning from your word in these days. Whether it's in our Sunday services, whether it's our Bible study online, whether it's one-to-one conversations, all of these things, Lord, help us to use them to learn and to grow in you and your word. Lord, you call us to build relationships. We're told that the early church devoted themselves to fellowship and that they were all together. And we pray, Lord, that we will all be devoted to spending time together required to forge meaningful relationships. That's hard in our current situation, as we think of the distances between us and brick walls that lay in the way. We long for relationship and closeness. Help us to find new ways, Lord. New ways to strengthen relationships and to build relationships. Thank you, Lord, for friendships that we already have in our church fellowship, but help us to develop new friendships. Help us to understand one another. Our experiences mark us and make us, but you also can shape us, Lord. In our relationships, Lord, mark and make us. Help us to think about who else we could deepen our relationship with in these days. You call us to pray together. The early church devoted themselves to prayer. Whenever they met, in homes for a meal, they would spend time in prayer. Lord, we don't have the luxury of meeting one another, but we do have the luxury of prayer, the necessity of prayer. Help us to build prayer into our lives from the moment we wake to when we go to sleep. Help us to delight in prayer. We also think about how the early church met needs. The early believers sold their possessions and property and distributed the proceeds to all as those had the need. We pray, Lord, that as a church, you would help us to be sacrificial in our generosity just now. Help us to be giving people, that we'd always seek to meet each other's needs, especially at this time. And they grew and added to their number. We thank you, Lord, for the people and families who we wouldn't normally have encountered on a Sunday, but are watching here in this moment. We thank you for each one of them, each one person who's maybe he's never been in this building, but is watching just now. We pray your blessing upon them. Help them to feel in a smallest sense that they're a part of this church, even just through watching this video. And we pray, Lord, that when our church reopens, we will continue to be open and to grow in love and fellowship and understanding and in our service to others. Father God, open our hearts towards others and towards you. Break down and melt within us the resistance that we erect against others. Make us to be of one heart and one mind with others in the body. Generous in giving, glad to participate in anything that advances this marvelous work going on in the midst of a world which is in such darkness, emptiness, and coldness. Thank you, Lord, for the warmth of your spirit and for your power and for your grace among your people just now. Amen.
Remember no wrongs we have done, all mission. sorrowing, he drowns not their son, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. So tender, he's calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood beneath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
So it's the middle of June, it's 14th of June, and today should have been our YP prize giving, but that wasn't to be. But we look forward later in the year to celebrating all the young people together. In the meantime, however, on a Sunday evening at 6:30, we're all, the young people are all welcome to share together in the Sweet Dreams Factory. It's a lovely opportunity to listen to some stories, to share prayer and a song. So keep an eye out for that.
Yes, you need a secret key to get inside, a secret code. And if you contact us or one of the YP leaders, they'll be able to give you the access for to be able to do that. But it's such a lovely time to be able to share with our young people, two of whom now are going to share one of their favourite songs. Not a song we use a great deal in church, but a really energetic, full of life song that reminds us that Jesus never leaves us. So it's over to you, Erin and Olivia.
Oh, hi everybody, hope you're doing well.
We picked You Will Never Run Away
because it is fun and energetic and teaches you about God's love.
Bye!
Hope to see you.
The reading is taken from Acts Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. They spent their time in learning from the apostles, taking part in the fellowship, and sharing in the fellowship meals and the prayers. Many miracles and wonders were being done through the apostles, and everyone was filled with awe. All the believers continued together in close fellowship and shared their belongings with one another. They would sell their property and possessions and distribute the money among all according to what each one needed. Day after day, they met as a group in the temple, and they had their meals together in their homes, eating with glad and humble hearts, praising God and enjoying the goodwill of all the people. And every day, the Lord added to their group those who were being saved. Amen.
Good morning, and thank you to Francis for bringing us our Bible reading this morning. Some say this romantic vision of the church or the early church is just that, a romantic vision. Some would say that this church never really existed as Luke presents it to us in Acts. So why does Luke, the writer, provide this description that we read earlier? Perhaps he's trying to help us understand what the church can be when it gives itself to the gospel. We know for sure that the New Testament gives us lots of examples of far from perfect churches, but we find this. The early church was a learning, fellowshipping, praying, awe-filled, power-demonstrating, radically generous, consistent, glad, praiseworthy, well-thought-of, growing body of followers of Jesus. That's a really long sentence to say in one breath, and all of those descriptions are in the Bible reading that we heard. But 10 minutes wouldn't do justice to these words, so you might want to look again and study the text for yourself. You may be thinking how this can relate to us today in June, still in some sort of lockdown, still at home, still participating in an online service. And I guess we want to encourage us all to keep doing these things for the moment, socially distanced, but in future days, in new ways, as we begin to carve a road back to meeting together. So the first thing is that the followers of Jesus learnt. At the heart of the gospel is, at the heart of the church is the truth of the gospel. And we know that the heart of the gospel is Jesus. And so the followers, those early followers, spent time learning. And we need to do the same. You can do it on your own. It takes discipline, and only this week we chatted to a few folk who talked about how much they were enjoying the discipline of learning about Scripture and learning and discovering new things for themselves. And you know, it's okay if we need to get help in understanding the Bible. There's lots of material available, and we help each other, don't we, via conversation. So the first disciples devoted themselves, and this here, the Greek word used has the idea of constancy. They really wanted to get involved and to learn and to discover. They wanted to tell people about God and how he had saved them through Jesus and how they had been empowered and emboldened by the Holy Spirit in their lives. And a verse that Scott and I have come back to time and time again over these last few weeks is Psalm 119 and verse 2, and we've shared it with many of you. Blessed and favored by God are those who keep his testimonies and who consistently seek him and long for him with all their hearts. When I read these verses in Acts, I can see the early church evidencing this, can't you? But what about us? Are we consistently seeking him as individuals and as a body of his people? They fellowshipped together. In the 12th century, there was an English monk called Erard, and he called, when we do life together, spiritual friendship, we're to spend time with each other, care for each other, be willing to sacrifice for each other, give generously to each other, and share a common life, all in response to Jesus doing what he did for us. And we've had to rework all of that, haven't we, in these strange days. Fellowship has been made via a video call or a text message. Only recently we've been able to meet in one another's gardens. It might have been a plant left at your door. It might have been somebody calling with tea and treats. It might have been a conversation through a car window. Fellowship is seeing each other on the good days and on the bad, day in and day out. They prayed. They devoted themselves to prayer. And prayer, we know, opens the floodgates of divine power. And it did so in the early church, and it will do so here today in 2020. We have probably prayed more than we have ever done in these last months. We have prayed for people known to us, for people we've never met or know. And as the way opens, we need to keep on praying. We need to keep praying. They were awe-filled. I don't know whether you knew this, but the word awful was originally a good word. It meant full of awe. And in this sense, then, the early church was an awful church, meaning a great church. Now, I'm guessing that, you know, we've maybe used the word awful to describe a church or a meeting or something like that, and we've meant something completely different. And here, the word awful means good. It means great. And their fellowship was marked by the Holy Spirit's presence and by the awe that comes with these things. We move on to discover that the early church was characterized by God's power and at work in their lives and in the lives of the people around them. Powerful things happened through the apostles. People were healed physically and spiritually. Relationships were mended. Marriages were restored. Friendships were brought back together again. Bad habits were abandoned, and the chains of sin basically were loosened, and the gospel was proclaimed. And all of these signs and wonders were a hallmark of the early church. Are they a hallmark of our church today? They were radically generous. This marker, what an amazing picture that was. They had all things in common. They sold what they had and they gave it to those in need. They were also consistent. We read in verse 46, and day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes. It needs to be understood as well that this kind of fellowship does not just happen. It only happens when life is consistently lived together day by day, Luke tells us. And it's important to understand, because if your connection to the church is occasional, maybe inconsistent, you're actually shortchanging yourself. You're shortchanging yourself of relationships that only arise, I believe, from a life that's lived together. And now that's not to say that we get perfect relationships in the church, because none of us are perfect. But do you understand? Do you see that it's not really about good church attendance? It's about being family. And those things do not happen when you either are not present or you're rarely present. And it's been easy, hasn't it, to maybe sit in our jammies? I don't know, I can't see. And sing and watch the service. There's no rush to get out and up and out. But when we do begin to return to church, and we begin to recognize that our meeting will look different to how it looked 3 months ago, will we still be consistent? Jean Edwards said, the life of the believer was never intended to be experienced alone. They were glad, and Luke gives us a glimpse into, I guess, the disposition of the early church. They had glad and generous hearts, and all of these things sort of connect together. Here's what I have observed over 20-something years in ministry, that those who are invested in the life of the church, who are devoted to God's word, to fellowship, to prayer, to generosity, and to living life together, tend to be glad and generous and joyful. But if you come to see the church as a product to consume, or as just a service, a religious service, who, if we aren't devoted, and if we have no real commitment to investing ourselves in a shared life, I see that you can be unhappy. Now, there's one to talk about after the meeting. Discuss. They were praise-filled. In a few moments' time, we're going to sing together that lovely song that's a real favourite, 10,000 Reasons. And are our hearts praise-filled? Because if your relationship and your heart is primarily one of discontent and complaint, why? You know, is Jesus not so glorious that you can't find motivation to praise him? As we have heard over these last few weeks, Jesus stands in our midst. He's here with us, and he is there with you. And he is leading us onwards, showing us the way, and we praise him for that. They were well thought of, and I'm dipping down here in case you think I've got lost. A friend sent me a report during the week, obviously to make me laugh, but it was an index of who do we trust the most. This is it here. And apparently in 2020, that is, and nurses are at the top of the list, so well done if you're a nurse, then local pharmacies, and then doctors. And do you know what? I look to find ourselves, the clergy and priests were 54%, made us feel really, really good, didn't it? But it's really interesting. I wonder how would the early church have fared today in 2020. We laughed about this this diagram, this who's well thought of. We laughed about this together. But what about the early church? How would they have fared in 2020? Because back then, those outside the church thought well of them because of what they were doing and also what they were becoming. And we know that later on in the book of Acts, there's persecution is recorded against the Christians. But it's still the case that many who saw what was happening were amazed by it, respected it, and marveled, even though for whatever reason, they did not join. When Jesus is given rule in his church, he still will draw all men and women to himself. And finally, they were a growing church, and he will do the same with us if we seek to become this kind of family, united in the gospel, bold in our witness in whatever form that takes. If we're sincere in how we love, if we're faithful in our life together, God grants increase. And as John Stott said, this account in Acts need not be just history. It remains a living possibility for the church and the only way forward. The Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost and has never left the church. Praise God for that. But our responsibility is to humble ourselves to his authority, determined not to quench him and allow him his freedom. Some of those that joined the early Jesus movement, as it was known, had so little, it seemed, to offer. Many were what would have been termed as uneducated, unskilled. They had no material wealth to speak of, and yet they made themselves available to his cause, and that's all that was needed. I just pose the question, how available are we? Narrow is the road, my same. I'll follow where your spirit leads, are the words of a new song. Broken as my life may be, I will give you every piece. I hear you call, I am available. And I say, yes, Lord, I am available. So whatever you have at your disposal this week, whether it's time or talents, money or energy, creativity, or whatever else, may you devote it to the God who made it yours in the first place. Amen. Lord, we thank you for your word. And I just pray that as we have listened and as we have read it, I pray that it will not return void and that you will continue to speak to each person who has watched this service this morning. Amen.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the
It's been lovely to worship with you this Sunday morning. Great to be with you in your homes or wherever you've been. Don't forget to hang around till the very end of the video or the end of the service as we have our announcements with Eileen. But before then, we're going to close with a musical benediction. We share these words, though. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Send us up from here.
Good morning, everyone. And how grateful we are that during these days of separation, technology allows us to meet together in this way. The Core Facebook page provides details of how you can join the Sweet Dreams Factory tonight, Sunday at 6:30 p.m. The Core YouTube page provides details of how you can join our online Bible study led by Graham and Angela. And this week we will be tracing the theme of holiness. Zoom will be facilitating a prayer gathering this week, Tuesday, at 7:30 p.m. And we will be able to share together in prayer for our core, our town, our nation, and our world. The code for joining can be found on the Core Facebook page or via Scott, who will let you have it. There are two members of our core family who are celebrating birthdays this week. Tomorrow, Monday, it will be Major Linda, and on Tuesday, and I'm going to get into trouble for letting you know this, but Peter Askham celebrates his birthday as well. So for both Linda and Peter, we wish them a birthday filled with the joy of the Lord. God bless.